Acts. Chapter 19. Now while Apollos was in Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper districts, came down to Ephesus and found some disciples. And he said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" And they said to him, "On the contrary, we did not even hear whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" And they said, "Into John's baptism." And Paul said, "John baptized with a baptism of repentance, telling the people that they should believe into the one coming after him, that is, into Jesus." And when they heard this, they were baptized into the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. And there were in all about 12 men. And he entered into the synagogue and spoke boldly for 3 months, reasoning and persuading them in the things concerning the kingdom of God. But when some were hardened and would not be persuaded, speaking evil of the way before the multitude, he withdrew from them and separated the disciples, reasoning daily in the school of Tyrannus. And this took place for 2 years, so that all those dwelling in Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks. And God did works of power of no ordinary kind through the hands of Paul. So that even handkerchiefs or aprons were carried away from his body to the sick, and their diseases left them, and the evil spirits went out. But some of the Jewish exorcists who also went about took it upon themselves to name over those who had evil spirits the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, "I adjure you by the Jesus whom Paul preaches." And there were 7 sons of a certain Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, doing this. And the evil spirit answered and said to them, "Jesus I know of, and with Paul the first am acquainted, but who are you?" And the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped upon them, subdued both of them, and overpowered them, so that they escaped out of that house naked and wounded. And this became known to all, both Jews and Greeks, dwelling in Ephesus, and fear fell upon them all, and the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. And many of those who had believed came, confessing and making known their practices. And a considerable number of those who practiced magic brought their books together and burned them before all, and they counted up the price of them and found it to be 50,000 pieces of silver. Thus, the word of the Lord grew mightily and prevailed. And when these things were fulfilled, Paul purposed in his spirit to pass through Macedonia and Achaia and go to Jerusalem, saying, "After I have been there, I must also see Rome." And having sent into Macedonia 2 of those who served him, Timothy and Erastus, he himself stayed in Asia for a time. And about that time no small disturbance took place concerning the way. For a certain man named Demetrius, a silversmith who made silver shrines of Artemis, afforded no little business to the craftsmen. These he assembled together with the workmen of similar trades as well and said, "Men, you know that from this business we have our prosperity. And you observe and hear that not only at Ephesus but in almost all of Asia this Paul has persuaded and perverted a considerable number, saying that the gods being made by hands are no gods at all. And not only is there danger that our trade will come into disrepute, but also that the temple of the great goddess Artemis will be counted as nothing and that the magnificence of her whom the whole of Asia and the inhabited earth worships will also be overthrown." And when they heard this, they became full of rage and began to cry out, saying, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." And the city was filled with confusion, and they rushed with one accord into the theater, seizing Gaius and Aristarchus of Macedonia, Paul's traveling companions. And when Paul intended to enter into the populace, the disciples would not allow him. And some of the Asiarchs also, who were his friends, sent to him and entreated him not to venture into the theater himself. So then some were crying out one thing, and some another, for the assembly was in confusion, and the majority did not know for what cause they had come together. And they drew Alexander out of the crowd, the Jews having pushed him forward, and Alexander, motioning with his hand, wanted to make a defense to the populace. But when they realized that he was a Jew, one voice arose from all for about 2 hours, crying out, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." And the town clerk, having quieted the crowd, said, "Men of Ephesus, which of you men is there then who does not know that the city of the Ephesians is the temple keeper of the great Artemis and of the image fallen from Zeus? Since these things therefore cannot be disputed, you ought to be quiet and do nothing rash. For you have brought forth these men who are neither temple robbers nor blasphemers of our goddess. If then Demetrius and the craftsmen with him have a matter against anyone, courts are being conducted and there are proconsuls, let them bring charges against one another. But if you seek after anything further, it shall be settled in the legal assembly. For indeed we are in danger of being charged with insurrection for today's affair, since there is no reason for it, and with reference to it we will not be able to give an account concerning this disorderly gathering. And when he had said these things, he dismissed the assembly. Acts Chapter 20. And after the uproar had ceased, Paul, having sent for the disciples and having exhorted them, took leave of them and went off to go into Macedonia. And when he had passed through those parts and had exhorted them with many words, he came into Greece. And spent 3 months there. And when a plot was made against him by the Jews as he was about to set sail for Syria, he resolved to return through Macedonia. And so Peter of Berea, the son of Pyrrhus, accompanied him, as well as Aristarchus and Secundus of the Thessalonians and Gaius of Derbe and Timothy in the Asians, Tychicus and Trophimus. These had gone on ahead and were waiting for us at Troas. And we sailed away from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread and in 5 days came to them in Troas, where we spent 7 days. And on the first day of the week, when we gathered together to break bread, Paul conversed with them since he was to go forth on the next day, and he extended his message until midnight. And there were a considerable number of lamps in the upper room where we were gathered together. And a certain young man named Eutychus was sitting in the window and began to sink into deep sleep while Paul conversed longer, and when he had been overcome by sleep, he fell down from the third story and was taken up dead. But Paul went down and fell upon him, and embracing him, he said, "Do not make a commotion, for his soul is in him." And when he had gone up and broken the bread and eaten and had spoken for a considerable time, until daybreak, he therefore went forth. And they brought the boy alive and were comforted, and that not moderately. But we, going ahead onto the ship, set sail for Assos, from there intending to pick up Paul, for so he had arranged it, himself intending to go by foot. And when he met us in Assos, we picked him up and came to Mytilene. And sailing away from there, on the following day we arrived opposite Chios, and on the next day we put in at Samos. And on the day following we came to Miletus. For Paul had decided to sail past Ephesus so that he might not have to spend time in Asia, for he was hurrying so that if possible he might be in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. And from Miletus he sent word to Ephesus and called for the elders of the church. And when they came to him, he said to them, "You yourselves know, from the first day that I set foot in Asia, how I was with you all the time, serving the Lord as a slave with all humility and tears and trials which came upon me by the plots of the Jews. How I did not withhold any of those things that are profitable by not declaring them to you and by not teaching you publicly and from house to house, solemnly testifying both to Jews and to Greeks repentance unto God and faith in our Lord Jesus. And now, behold, I am going bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing what will meet me there. Except that the Holy Spirit solemnly testifies to me in city after city, saying that bonds and afflictions await me. But I consider my life of no account as if precious to myself, in order that I may finish my course and the ministry which I have received from the Lord Jesus to solemnly testify of the gospel of the grace of God. And now, behold, I know that you all, among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom, will see my face no more. Therefore I testify to you on this day that I am clean from the blood of all men. For I did not shrink from declaring to you all the counsel of God. Take heed to yourselves and to all the flock, among whom the Holy Spirit has placed you as overseers to shepherd the church of God, which he obtained through his own blood. I know that after my departure fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among you yourselves men will rise up, speaking perverted things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore watch, remembering that for 3 years, night and day, I did not cease admonishing each one with tears. And now I commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who have been sanctified. I have coveted no one's silver or gold or clothing. You yourselves know that these hands have ministered to my needs and to those who are with me. In all things I have shown you by example that toiling in this way we ought to support the weak and to remember the words of the Lord Jesus, that he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And when he had said these things, he knelt down with them all and prayed. And there was considerable weeping by all, and falling on Paul's neck, they kissed him affectionately. Especially pained over the word which he had spoken, that they would no longer behold his face. And they escorted him to the ship. Acts Chapter 21. And when we parted from them and set sail, we took a straight course and came to Kos, and on the next day to Rhodes, and from there to Patara. And having found a ship crossing over to Phoenicia, we went on board and set sail. And when we sighted Cyprus and left it on the left, we sailed to Syria and came down to Tyre, for there the ship was to unload its cargo. And when we had sought out the disciples, we remained there 7 days. These told Paul through the Spirit not to set foot in Jerusalem. And when we completed the days, we went forth and went on our way, with all of them, including the women and children, escorting us until we were outside the city. And when we had knelt down on the beach and prayed, we took leave of one another and went on board the ship, and they returned home. And when we finished the voyage from Tyre, we arrived at Ptolemy, and we greeted the brothers and remained with them 1 day. And on the next day we went forth and came to Caesarea, and entering into the house of Philip the evangelist, who was one of the 7, we remained with him. Now this man had 4 virgin daughters who prophesied. And while we remained there many days, a certain prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. And he came to us and took Paul's belt, and having bound his own feet and hands, he said, "Thus says the Holy Spirit, in this way will the Jews in Jerusalem bind the man whose belt this is and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles." And when we heard these things, both we and those in that place entreated him not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, "What are you doing, weeping and breaking my heart? For I am ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." And since he would not be persuaded, we became silent, saying, "The will of the Lord be done." And after these days we gathered our baggage and went up to Jerusalem. And some of the disciples from Caesarea also went with us, bringing us to a certain Mnason of Cyprus, an early disciple, with whom we were to lodge. And when we had come to Jerusalem, the brothers welcomed us gladly. And on the following day Paul went in with us to James, and all the elders were present. And having greeted them, he related one by one the things which God did among the Gentiles through his ministry. And when they heard it, they glorified God and said to him, "You observe, brother, how many thousands there are among the Jews who have believed, and all are zealous for the law. And they have been informed concerning you that you are teaching all the Jews throughout the nations apostasy from Moses, telling them not to circumcise their children, nor to walk according to the customs. What then is to be done? They will certainly hear that you have come. Therefore do this that we tell you, we have 4 men who have a vow on themselves. Take these and be purified with them, and pay their expenses that they may shave their heads. And all will know that there is nothing to the things that they have been informed of concerning you, but that you yourself also walk orderly, keeping the law. But concerning the Gentiles who have believed, we have already written, having decided that they should keep themselves from idol sacrifices and blood and anything strangled and fornication." Then Paul took the men and on the following day, being purified with them, entered into the temple, giving notice of the completion of the days of the purification, until the offering was offered for each one of them. And when the 7 days were about to be concluded, the Jews from Asia saw him in the temple and threw all the crowd into confusion, and they laid their hands on him, crying out, "Men of Israel, help! This is the man who teaches all men everywhere against the people and the law and this place, and further, he has even brought Greeks into the temple and has profaned this holy place." For they had previously seen Trophimus the Ephesian in the city with him, whom they supposed Paul had brought into the temple. And the whole city was stirred, and the people ran together, and they laid hold of Paul and dragged him outside the temple, and immediately the doors were shut. And as they were seeking to kill him, a report came up to the commander of the cohort that all Jerusalem was in confusion. And he at once took soldiers and centurions and ran down to them. And when they saw the commander and the soldiers, they stopped beating Paul. Then the commander drew near and laid hold of him and ordered him to be bound with 2 chains. And he inquired who he might be and what he had done. And some among the crowd were shouting one thing, and some another. And since he could not find out the facts because of the uproar, he ordered him to be brought into the barracks. And when Paul came to the stairs, it so happened that he was being carried by the soldiers because of the violence of the crowd. For the multitude of the people were following and crying out, "Away with him!" And when he was about to be brought into the barracks, Paul said to the commander, "Am I allowed to say anything to you?" And he said, "You know Greek. You are not then the Egyptian who some days ago revolted and led out the 4,000 men of the assassins into the wilderness." But Paul said, "I am a Jewish man of Tarsus in Cilicia, a citizen of no insignificant city, and I beg you, permit me to speak to the people." And when he had given him permission, Paul stood on the stairs and motioned with his hand to the people. And when there was a great silence, he addressed them in the Hebrew dialect, saying,